Does your game need juice? No, not that kind. This kind. Adding game feel or juice into your game is something that a lot of indies will skip over because they don't know it's important or they're rushed to push out a game. That leaves them with a game that feels boring or bland and doesn't get a lot of players. In this video, I'm going to show you how really easily you can add some juicy behaviors, interactions, and attention seekers into your game using springs. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy, here to help you.
Me?
Yes, you! Make your game dev dreams become a reality by adding juice into your game by using springs. First off, I have to give credit to Toyful Games, who first got me interested in looking at how to use springs to add juice into your game. They had a tutorial kind of showing the high level how do you implement a spring, and I felt like there was some more that could have been done in that video to dive a little bit deeper to give you some practical hands-on live code that you could use. Maybe you used the spring joint in Unity before. That's where you attach a rigid body to this component and it kind of bounces around some object using a spring. That uses the physics system to calculate the position and rotation of a particular object. You can even hook up multiple of them together to get some really funny results, but maybe you can also use it to get some interesting, good, useful results. That works really well when we're trying to have a physics object get sprung around in world space. There's a lot more applications to springs. We're gonna apply that exact same concept to how can we manipulate arbitrary values on game objects without having to create animation curves or really detailed animation clips. For example, we can adjust the scale to get like a jelly bounce effect. We can adjust the position to give a little shake. We can adjust the rotation to do a little attention seeking. And we can even combine all of those together to get a really loud object in our scene. Before we dive in too much to that practical example, let's talk a little bit about what are springs. Springs move according to something called simple harmonic motion, which looks a little bit something like this. Basically, what that means is that this object's gonna bounce back and forth forever around some equilibrium point at a consistent and predictable acceleration, provided that no other force acts upon it. And as you can see on this Wikipedia article, there's a lot of math that goes into that. Honestly, probably most of us don't care too much about the math behind it. I'm sure there are people who care and tell you that you need to know. Math was never my strong suit, so I'm very happy somebody figured this out. If you do care a lot about the details of this, I've got the links in the description to the Wikipedia page and a really good write-up by Ryan Juckett from back in 2012 explaining how to do this and kind of walking through those proofs. For me, the important part was that at the end, we have some set of equations that we can apply to manipulate a float value based on a couple of different float values. Even more luckily, Famine on GitHub has already provided us some really basic framework to use springs that basically just have these equations inside of class. So what we're gonna do is take those, we're gonna use just one from them that has how can we manipulate some float value based on springiness, dampness, and a couple other fields. Let's jump into Visual Studio, take a look at what mono behaviors do I have in place? How did I modify Famine's code to make it more usable in this framework? And as always, remember the full project code is available on GitHub for free. You're free to use it in any of your projects. Before we get too much into that, I want to tell you about a special deal that's going on right now. Over on humblebundle.com, you can get a pay what you want Ultimate Fantasy Unity RPG Developer Bundle, where you can get up to 29 items for as low as just over a dollar per item. I got an affiliate link down in the description. This is from Infinity PBR, and if you haven't seen any of their assets before, you've probably never been on the asset store. They have so many high quality, realistic, and more recently, some low poly assets that are just amazing. Most of their assets come with a huge amount of customization. You can do blend shapes to modify the mesh, so that way you don't need to even open up a 3D modeling program. You can just kind of tweak some stuff and get a totally different look than whatever you saw on the asset store. And these also usually come with quite a few different materials as well, so you can really play around with some different looks and feels. On top of all of the assets that are in this pack, there's also a three-part game dev mastery course from the one and only Jason Wieman. I think that's right. Sorry, Jason. This is a really great value. Anytime anything like this comes up on Humble Bundle, I am buying them because that's a really great value for me to be able to get a large quantity of these assets for a relatively inexpensive price. If you're building a fantasy themed game, definitely check this out. First link in the description is going to have a link to that Humble Bundle. There are two main classes that we got from Paul Young, who published this under Famine Unity Spring. Number one is what I renamed to be the base spring, which has a couple of key values. We have damping, mass, and stiffness. These three values will control basically how springy the spring is. If we lower the damping value, the more oscillating we'll get the spring to do. So for example, if we put it all the way down to 0.01 or very close to zero, the spring will move according to those simple harmonic principles that we saw on that Wikipedia page. If we put the damping very high, then basically it will not look springy. The stiffness affects how stiff the spring is, so it makes it move more quickly or slowly. You can also see that the mass plays a role in the damping and the stiffness equation, so this is another parameter that we can play with, but in my examples, I have left this alone at 1 all of the time. Because this is an abstract class of a generic type, what we can do is subclass base spring t, and I already have, to achieve these functions. So we have reset, which would reset all the initial states, update end value, which we will call if the spring is currently active and we want to change that end point. And there's an overloaded update end value that we will call if we want to preserve the velocity or mutate that velocity. And finally, the key one that we want to use whenever we want the spring to evaluate is evaluate, where we pass in the delta time, which will almost always be time.delta time. Kind of the workhorse class that we have here is the float spring. In most cases, we want to modify a float or several floats using a spring. For example, remember that transform position, rotation, and scale all are just a collection of floats. In here, we have the very long evaluate function. The key things to note here is when we're evaluating, we're updating the current value, the current velocity, and we are returning the current value. For convenience, I've also implemented a spring vector 2 and a spring vector 3. These essentially just group 2 float springs together, or 3 float springs together, for the vector 2 and vector 3 representations. So we actually override our types of initial velocity, start value, end value, current velocity, current value, where the getters and setters have been overridden to return and set values on the x and y, and for the vector 3 spring, also the z. This way, each implementing class doesn't have to manually manage multiple springs. They can only utilize spring vector 2 or spring vector 3. All of these are just extending that base spring class. Because in 3D, we're primarily dealing with a vector 3 spring, this makes it very easy for us to spring any vector 3 value. For any 2D projects, you can then use spring vector 2. In any cases that we only want to modify a singular float, then we would just use the float spring. I was hard pressed to come up with any other use cases, so this is kind of where I stopped this framework, but you can follow this exact same pattern if you need to have some other kind of spring. So these are basically the data model version. The base spring does not extend the mono behavior, so these are just plain C# classes. I've also provided in this a collection of runtime-based mono behavior C# scripts. Let's take a look at some of those now. I want to take a second to give a huge shout out to all of my Patreon supporters. Every one of you is helping this channel grow, reach more people, and add value to more people, and that helps more people make their game development dreams become a reality. If you've been getting value out of these videos, consider becoming a Patreon supporter. Go over to patreon.com/LlamAcademy, get your name up here on the screen, get a voice shout out starting at the awesome tier, and some other cool perks at the tremendous and phenomenal tier levels. Speaking of the phenomenal tier level, I have Andrew Bowen, and at the awesome tier, I have Gerald Anderson, Autumn K, Matt Parkin, and Ivan. Thank you all for your support. I am so grateful.
The first runtime class that we want to take a look at, which you'll notice is the LlamAcademy Spring Runtime namespace now, is the base spring behavior. This just provides us some mono behavior base class that will allow us to modify dampening and stiffness. It will also allow us to change these at runtime in the inspector and give us a framework to apply those updates. Notice that it does not have a spring defined. This is intentional because we do not want to specify what type of spring we want to use. Any subclasses would then be responsible for defining that spring. Before we look at those, there's two other key pieces, the iNudgeable, which just says you have to implement a nudge function, and an interface iSpring2, which just defines a spring2 function of some generic type. So we can spring to a float value, a vector 3 or vector 2 value is what we're going to look at today. Let's start with the simple 2D examples. We have a spring2target 2D. All of the classes we're about to look at follow this exact same pattern. We're starting with the most simple one, but I think once we go over one, the rest of them will be very clear. So we'll notice that this extends the base spring behavior, not the mono behavior, and it implements the iSpring2 and the iNudgeable interfaces, both the vector2. We also define a private spring vector2 spring because we're going to use a vector2 spring. That makes a lot of sense. On awake, we'll set the spring to equal a new spring vector2 where we define the start and end value to be the current transform position and assign the damping and stiffness values. We've also created a check inspector changes for applying the changes from the damping and stiffness to the spring. That way, any values we've changed in the inspector are reflected in the spring behavior. In that spring 2 vector 2 target position that we've implemented, we will first stop all coroutines. We call this check inspector changes, so that way we get the new spring that looks like it's supposed to be, and then we'll start a coroutine that will actually do the springing to target. I'm specifically not doing this on update because most likely a lot of the time your springs will not be evaluating anything, so we do not want the extra overhead that comes from an update loop. We will only execute this code when we should be springing. That do spring to target looks like this, where we're checking, is this spring currently moving? That's mathf.approximately spring.current velocity square magnitude zero. We're basically checking if the spring is not currently moving, we will reset it. So set it all back to the default, set the start value to be the current position and the end value to be whatever that target position is. Then in that scenario, we will then loop while our positions are approximately not equal, meaning we've not fully reached that target position. We will then set the position to be whatever spring.evaluate returns, which in this case would be the result of two float springs evaluating on the X and the Y axis respectively. And we pass in, as I said earlier, the time.delta time, which is just the time step that we're evaluating. Internally on those springs, they're tracking this time. And that's why it's important that we do spring.reset. If we don't call that spring reset, then this time doesn't get reset. And you will notice that the springs over time become less springy. Finally, at the end, we call spring.reset to ensure that they don't have any kind of residual velocity left over. In the case that we call do spring to target and we're already moving, that's this else case, we're just going to call spring.update end value, where we pass in the target position and I'm passing the spring.current velocity. That's not really necessary. That's the default value. That handles this case where we're just clicking around on a 2D plane, moving the target position essentially. What we haven't looked at, what happens if we nudge? In that nudge function, we're doing a very similar check to check, is this spring currently moving? We still call check inspector changes. If it's not currently moving, we start a coroutine to handle the nudge. Otherwise, we're just updating the end value, and we're doing a little bit different thing here is we want to tell it, here's the current velocity, but we're going to add in this nudge amount. That way, we're not changing anything about the spring, except that its current velocity just received a nudge. In the handle nudge, it looks very much the same as what we just did. We reset the spring, we set the start and end value to be the same point because we want it to return back to its current location. And then we set the initial velocity of the spring to be this nudge amount. We then just loop in this coroutine until we have a return to that equilibrium position, that target position, evaluating a spring on the X and the Y. And finally, at the end, we reset. You'll see the exact same patterns are applied for spring to rotation, spring to scale, and spring to target 3D. So those are the ones that I've provided in this repository already, which will allow us to do all kinds of stuff that you've been seeing throughout this video, where arbitrary UI elements or 3D elements can be rotated, slightly nudged side to side, totally move from one point to another point, and even kind of get that juicy scale transform that we've been seeing. As you can see, there's a lot of things that we can change very simply by either using the float spring, the vector 2 spring, or the vector 3 spring. Of course, you can implement any arbitrary spring type using the same patterns you've seen today. I found this to be a lot of fun to mess with the different settings to get whatever kind of interesting effects are going on here, and I can't wait to implement even more of these into my own games. Remember, the full project code is available on GitHub. If you'd like to contribute to that because you found that you needed to extend this framework in some way, go ahead and open up a pull request, help out the community that's going to check out that repo in the future. And as always, if you got value out of this video, please consider liking and subscribing to help the channel grow, reach more people, and add value to more people. This new video is posted every tutorial Tuesday, and I'll see you next week.